Well, I'm using digital video for my courses, and it's not entirely related to Blackboard, but I've been struggling with formatting videos so that they can be put up on Blackboard for students to use. And at the time, there were really very few services for faculty to provide those kinds of videos, encoding and transferring and capturing and all that. So about 3 years ago, I took it upon myself to learn that stuff. And of course, now a lot of that is automated. So other faculty can come in and just, put in a videotape and it spits out a DVD on the other end. But I actually enjoyed the process of learning. So I do all my own capturing, encoding, editing, and depending on how it's going to be presented to students, the final product can be anything from a DVD to a streaming video and various formats in between. The course that I started this with is a course called Peoples of the World, which is a comparative anthropology course. And it was the videos there were originally an enhancement of the reading material. But I found that because it's about comparative cultures and really students need to see that and experience that, and I can't take them, the next best thing is to use video. So that was really, it was a supplementary role, but then it began to have the central role where I would show the video and not just, the usual way is here's a video for half an hour, take notes, and then see you tomorrow. But I don't do it that way. I show 5 minutes, stop the tape, stop the video and talk. And what did you think about that? And so to show 1 hour of video can take 3 or 4 hours of class time. And I've done it for this other course, Introduction to the Social Sciences, where there really doesn't need to be a lot of reading and writing and stuff. It's really to introduce students to the whole idea of what is social science, what do the social sciences do. So I started the semester with a narrative film, a 90-minute film. Now, the conventional approach would be to show 45 minutes on 2 days with no commentary or very little. But I actually stretched that 90-minute film out to 8 or 9 class sessions of 45 minutes apiece because I found that, there's a danger in using visual sources in that we presume a level of visual literacy on the part of students that in many ways on the level of entertainment and fascination, but not on the level of reading. So if I want to treat the video as a text, I've got to teach students to read the video as a text. So I almost came back around to my original problem, which is now we're talking about reading again, except we're reading a visual source instead of a printed source. But it's been a journey for me, and I think that students are visually literate in ways that they're not necessarily in reading, so there's more to build on. And so, I also decenter the narrative of the video by not letting it speak for itself only for 90 minutes or 60 minutes or whatever. I intervene often, and I fill the board with notes, vocabulary, and then I set up a discussion board on Blackboard where I encourage students, in fact, build it into the percentage of the grade for the course so that they need to discuss on their own time and outside of class what this film might mean to them. And then I sort of season those discussions with pointed questions about the relevance to the course topic. So it's evolving a whole way of teaching that is, not dependent on books and the text. And as I said, it's a strategic choice. There's a philosophy behind it, but I don't know if I would say everybody should do that. I mean, what would that mean for the future of the university and libraries and all that? So we don't need to take it that far. But I think as a methodology for some classes, it served me quite well. I think one of the points I started to realize by using video is that the whole purpose of using a video in the classroom for me has changed by doing this, in that I've found that I've made a decision that the content of the course, in other words, what we're talking about, the subject, the topic, in some cases can be presented without doing a lot of reading and writing. And that I found in some courses, in fact, that by having students, for example, give them a 20-page article and write a paper about it, the conventional teaching approach was really turning the course into a writing course. And I taught a lot of courses that way, but I realized that, you know, the focus becomes on the writing part, the articulation, the reading, the comprehension issues. And I, not only me, but I think a lot of teachers were struggling with this issue of the content. So I began to use videos first to enhance the reading and writing, but in some courses now I'm using it to replace the reading and the writing. To some students that's unsettling because they want to just slip into the groove of being entertained. And I make jokes about that. I say, you know, we're not having, you know, candy and soda here watching being entertained. This is a learning experience. So I explain to them what I'm doing. But that's one of the initial responses. But then after doing it for a couple of times, the students really come to appreciate it. And they say that, you know, I saw this movie before, but I never really saw it until we watched it. And I didn't realize so much was in here. And those are sort of, you know, epistemological kinds of things that come out of the experience. But there's also, of course, just the content. I mean, they can see something illustrated. Like there was one film that had a session between a psychiatrist and a therapist. And you can explain that and you can read about that, but to watch how that happens is unparalleled except on video. I would say that, don't feel intimidated by perhaps using more technology in your teaching than you're used to using, because it's, you know, you need to think of it in another way, that there are these video sources and that it might be useful for your class. So think of it in the use value, and then the technological part has actually become quite easy.